Atkins. Normal basis of eigenvectors x1, xn. So from now on and up to the end of this lecture, x1, xn will be the eigenvector, an orthonormal base of the eigenvectors of the matrix of G. Okay? So this will be always the eigenvectors. With real eigenvalues, so lambda 1 larger than lambda 2 larger than lambda n. Okay, so we just set an arbitrary order on the eigenvalues. Okay, and we just sort them by decreasing order. So this comes from linear algebra. Okay, this is true for any real symmetric matrix. Okay, so now we can say more in our case. Okay, so lemma: since M is the transition matrix of the regular graph. So in all this lecture, this is really important that the graph is dirregular. Because as you may know, when you have an iterated graph, and that you do a random walk on this graph, then you end up, you converge towards a distribution where you visit each vertex with a probability proportional to its degree. Okay? The more edges you have, the more likely you will be to come here. Okay? So it's really easy to prove. And in the case the graph is irregular, then you converge to the uniform distribution. Okay? So this is exactly what we will show in this lemma. What's going on? So M is the transition matrix of a irregular graph. So then one lambda 1 is 1. Okay. X1 is 1 over square root of n. 1, 1, 1, okay, that's the uniform distribution. And for all I, the absolute value of lambda I is less than 1. That's a lot for a 1. Okay, so it's. And 2, for all I larger than 2, xi, the sum over u in v of xi u is 0. So let's review it. Proof. So a proof is fairly easy, okay? The fact that all the eigenvalues are less than 1, it's simply the fact that M is double. I didn't tell what the eigenvector means. Okay, so let me just say. That is to say, for all I, xi M is lambda I xi. Okay, this is an eigenvector, a left eigenvector. Okay, but it's more convenient for random walks. We don't care since M is symmetric. Okay, so we could do the random walk backward, but it's more convenient to do it forward. Okay. So, proof. So M is doubly stochastic. So, proof. So, one. So the matrix M is positive. Okay? It's positive. So if so take take X with norm 1 equals to 1. So the norm 1 of x times m is equal, so since m is taking an average of x, okay, it's less than 1.
X is any vector? Or?
X is any vector, yes. But you're basically, m is a doubly stochastic matrix. Okay, so it computes an average, each coefficient is an average. Is it enough to say so. Well, yeah, let's say that the following. It's less than the... You take the absolute value of each coefficient times m. And what is that? It's the sum over all u of the sum over v of the absolute value of x v. The sum over u of sum over v of x v times m v v u. Okay. So this is absolute times m index u. Okay. So the L1 norm. So everything is positive now. Okay. So the L1 norm of that is the sum over all u of this coordinate, the coordinate of this product here, and this is that. Okay, so now I can exchange the sum, and it's the sum over v of x v times the sum over u of mvu. But this is 1 because it's doubly stochastic. Okay, so this is 1. So what does this say, basically? This says that this is just because it's a transition matrix. It's the transition matrix. So if you take a distribution, some probability that sum to 1, okay, and apply the Markov chains matrix, the transition matrix, which is a Markov chain, then you get a distribution which sums to 1. So the L1 norm of x times n is 1, at most 1. Okay? But on the other hand, if x times n is equal to some, it's an eigenvector, some li times x, okay? If x is an eigenvector, so simply take x, the easiest is to take x equals xi over the norm 1 of x, I. Okay, so you take the eigenvector of norm 1 for absolute value lambda, and what you get is that the L1 norm of x m is equal to absolute value of lambda I times norm 1 of x. This is 1, this is less than 1. So lambda I is less than 1. Okay, this is true for any doubly stochastic matrix. Okay, I could have put it in the linear algebra form. Okay, so now we know that all the eigenvectors are less than 1 in absolute value. So now, the only thing that we want to say is that there is an eigenvector whose eigenvalue is 1, so that's easy, because we have the eigenvector, so you just have to take the image.
The norm 1 is the sum of the absolute values, in fact? The norm 1 is that the sum of the absolute value?
Yes. Okay. Yep. Yeah. Okay, so we have shown the last point of 1. So now let's verify that... So let's take the image of 1 over square root of n, 1 n times m. So if you look at the new coordinate of this vector, it's simply the sum over v of n uv times 1 over square root of n. Okay? You should take the image. Sorry. So let's take v, sum over u. But this is simply 1 over square root of n times degree of v over d, which is 1 square root of n. 1 over square root of n. So, in fact, this vector is indeed an eigenvector with eigenvalue 1. Okay? There's nothing to say. So, what does this say? It says that the uniform distribution, okay, is a fixed point for the random walk on this graph, on a deregular graph. Okay? So, this is really basic stuff. Huh? I just mean by that that we get more complicated afterward. And, but for good reason. This is tedious because it's simple and you just have to write it. Okay, so now, and the point 2. Point 2 is simply because xi is an orthonormal basis. Okay, so for I larger than 2, xi is perpendicular to x1. Okay, but x1 is the vector 1 over square root of n, 1, 1. Okay, so what does this mean, xi perpendicular to x1? This just means that the scalar product of xi with the vector 1 over square root of n, 1, 1, is equal to 0, but this is equal to 1 over square root of n times the sum over u of xi u. Okay? So basically, the average value of the over eigenvectors is 0. Okay? Being perpendicular to the uniform distribution means that your average is 0. Okay, so this will be useful from time to time. Good. So now we would like to have a formula that tells us what are the eigenvalues. So let me tell you just a second, why do we care about that when we deal with random walks? What do we care about that when we do random walks? It's simply because if P, so let's say PU is probability distribution over the vertices V. Okay, so for instance, it's where the probability distribution of the point at the beginning. Okay, then P times M is the probability distribution starting from a random point chosen with probability PU. Okay, the probability distribution of the probability distribution starting of the position after one random step in G. Oh, so this is completely trivial. What is the probability? The probability of being, so the probability to be at V after one step. So you take a vertex V and you ask the question, what is the probability to be at V after one step, one random step? It's simply the sum over all the U that are neighbors of V.
So can you explain again the sentence you just spoke?
I think it will be clearer afterwards. Okay, so basically what you do is you pick a vertex U with probability P U, okay, and you do a random one step of a random walk. That means to select a random neighbor of U.
So it's the distribution of getting to that U.
Of getting to that V. Okay, you pick a random U. Okay, you just select a random vector of a random neighbor of U, and this is V. And what I say is that the probability to be at V is exactly P times M index by V. So why is it so? Because the probability to be at V after one step is the probability, is the sum over all the neighbors of V, all the neighbors U of V, of being at U at the beginning and selecting the neighbors V, the neighbor V, which is the number of edges between U and V over D. Okay? But by definition, this is MUV. So this is really P times MV. Okay? The probability that I at step V after one random step, okay, it's simply the probability to choose the neighbor of U of V, and this happens with probability PU, and then to get from U to V, which is the number of edges between U and V over D. Okay, and by definition, this is MU. Okay? So, as a corollary, starting from a probability distribution P at time t equals 0, the distribution, the probability distribution after t random step in G is P times M to the T. So this is not the transpose, okay, this is time. Yeah. Okay, this is a really bad notation. So let's say time 2 after tau step. Okay. So the distribution is simply M P times M tau. So what can I say about that? What can I say about this distribution? I can say the following, is that let's write P. P is a probability distribution. Okay? So P is a probability distribution. So if I sum over all the vertex PU, this is equal to 1. Okay? So recall that the XI is a basis, an orthonormal basis. Okay, the XI is an orthonormal basis. So I can write P as the sum over I of the P scalar XI, XI. Okay, I can decompose P over the eigenvectors of the transition matrix. Now, what is my distribution Q after T step? Let Q tau be P times M to the tau. What can I say about Q tau? Q tau is simply the sum over I of p scalar xi times xi n to the tau. But this is lambda I to the tau xi. Okay? So basically, what's going on? Imagine that this lambda I is strictly less than 1. Okay? Imagine that for all I but 1, lambda I is strictly less than 1. Then basically, what's going on is that the coordinates, the component of P along all the eigenvectors but 1 will exponentially decrease at a rate which is the maximum of lambda 2, the absolute value of lambda 2 and lambda n. Okay? So what do I want to say now is that Q tau minus the uniform distribution. So by the way, what is this value here? P is x1. Because P is a probability distribution, the sum of the PU is 1. Okay? This is by definition. But okay? And by definition, this is a probability distribution, it's 1. So this is 1 over square root of n. It should be something else. Yeah, no, that's okay. Okay, so the scalar product of any probability distribution with x1 is always 1 over square root of n. Okay? So basically, what's going on here? Q tau, after tau step of a random walk, it's equal to 1 over square root of n x1 plus the sum over I larger than 2 of lambda I tau xi. Okay? So imagine for a while that lambda I is strictly less than 1 in absolute value. Imagine that in absolute value, this is less than 1. So imagine that. Okay. Then what's going on? This, in norm, will go to 0 exponentially fast. And what remains here, it's 1 over square root of n times 1 square root of m, 1, 1, 1. This is 1 over n, the vector 1 over n, 1 over n, which is the uniform distribution. Okay? So basically, as soon as all the eigenvalues, which are not lambda 1, are strictly less than 1 in absolute value, then your distribution converges really fast to the uniform distribution, exponentially fast. Okay? So basically, we have some kind of random network. Okay? After only log n step, basically, you're almost uniform. You have a random vertex. Even if you have just a d-regular graph at the beginning, okay? You have at each time step, you have only d choice. And this is enough. So if this is true, if all these eigenvalues are strictly less than 1, then you have this mixing property. And you converge really fast to the uniform distribution.
And when you have a case in which it is not 1?
That's the problem. So that's where we are going now. So now our problem is to study these eigenvalues and relate them to the extender property. So before doing that, we need to understand better how these eigenvalues relate to graph properties. Okay? So what we've seen here is basically if they are strictly less than 1, then it will mix well. Okay? After a few number of steps, I will converge to the uniform distribution. Okay? So let's try to formalize that. I mean, by formalizing, let's try to prove it more in depth, understanding more deeply what's going on. What time is it?
6h-4.
Ok, bon, allez, c'est pas grave. Alors, on va pas tout prouver. On va pas prouver le fait. So basically, we will give some norm characterization. So let's try to define the eigenvalues in terms of the geometry. So let's say geometric characterization. Geometric characterization of the eigenvalues. So this is a theorem, which is again very classic from linear algebra, which is called the Rayleigh ratios. So again, this is true for every symmetric matrix. Okay, so since M is a real symmetric matrix, then for all I, lambda I is the max over all x perpendicular to x1, xi minus 1. Okay, so you look at the orthogonal of this, the I minus 1 first eigenvectors. So if I equals 1, there is no restriction. X different from 0, x in Rn. Okay, of the ratio xm, the scalar product of xm with x over the scalar product of x with itself. Okay, so this is point one, and in particular this is almost a corollary, it's a corollary of the proof. Okay, you just replace the proof, is that lambda, the max of lambda 2 and lambda n, or let's say the max of the lambda I larger than 2, which is equal to the max of lambda 2 and lambda n, is the max over x perpendicular to x1. So in fact, of writing perpendicular to x1, I would just write perpendicular to 1, since we know that the vector x1 is 1 over square root of n, 1 over 1. Okay? X different from 0 of the absolute value of over x, xt. Okay? So recall that this is the scalar product of x with x, which is the square of its L2 norm, and this is the scalar product of x with xn, or xn with x, if you prefer. We don't care because it's symmetric. Okay. So you look at what is the angle, basically, what is the angle between x and mx? Okay, by how much do you shift somehow? That's metric. So basically, if you have x1 here, okay, you look at the perpendicular space, you look at x, x is here, you look at its component, you impose that x is orthogonal to m, you look at basically the angle here between x and mx, and this gives you the angle is maximized at lambda 2. Okay, that's what we say, more or less. Okay, so it's geometric. Okay, so
what's the max lambda 2 lambda n?
Because I've sorted the eigenvalues by lambda 1 larger than lambda 2 larger than lambda n. Okay, so the max of the absolute value of lambda I is either lambda 2 or at the other end lambda n, the absolute value. Okay. Okay, if lambda n is negative. If lambda n is not negative, we don't care. Okay, so I could more or less remove the absolute value around lambda 2. So why is this coefficient here important? So this, we will call it lambda 2 bar. This is lambda 2 bar of G. or let's say lambda of g. Let's do it simple. Let's keep it simple. Okay, it's lambda of g. We define the max of all the other lambda, all the other eigenvalues over van lambda 1, we call it lambda g. Okay, and what's going on is that if you recall here, what was going on is that the difference between from there, the difference between the probability distribution after tau step and the uniform distribution. Okay, what does it say here is that this is less than lambda of g to the 2. This is what we've shown here. Okay, the difference in norm 1, it's also true in norm 2. It's less than lambda g to the 2. Okay? So if this lambda g is less strictly less than 1, then we have an exponentially fast convergence. Okay, so that's why we focus on that. So where does it come from? I think I need to prove it because else you... So the proof is completely trivial. It's just decompose the vector over the eigenvectors. Okay? Just use that the eigenvectors are 1, so we'll just prove the point 1. So 1. Alors, take I in 1n. Okay? X perpendicular to x1. Xi minus 1, that means that x is the sum for j larger than I of some coefficient alpha j, which is the scalar product of x with xj, times xj. Okay? So now let's compute xm times xt. It's simply the sum over j larger than I of alpha j xj m times the sum over j prime larger than I alpha j prime xj prime. Let's k. Okay? So let's choose one side or the other. Let's say this side. So it's the sum over j larger than I of alpha j lambda j xj. Okay? I can just use factorize this way, okay, times the sum over k larger than I of alpha k xk. Okay, but for k different from j, xj and xk are transpose. So if I the scalar product of xj with sk is 0, okay, and otherwise it's 1, so it's simply the sum over j larger than I of alpha j square. Okay, because the norm of xj is 1 and xj is orthogonal with xk. Okay, so it's just, okay, and this is simply xt. So there should be, there is a mistake somewhere.
The lambda j.
Lambda j, thank you. Thank you, lambda j. Okay, and this is less than, this is positive. Okay, I don't know the sign of the lambda j. Okay, but since this is positive, this is less than the max over j larger than I of lambda j times the sum over j larger than I of alpha j square, which is x scalar product with x. Okay, so I have that the max and lambda j, the max of that is simply lambda j, lambda I, by definition, since I have sorted the lambda I. Okay, so I have that lambda I is larger than this ratio. So now I just need to show that there is some vector for which this is equal. Okay, and clearly for xi, this is equal. Okay, because here you don't have the less or equal. Okay? So let's add here the precision to this lemma, to this theorem, and it is attained for x equal xj, x equal xi. For x equal xi, you have equality. Okay, so what we've shown is that for all x, this is at least that. And you have equality for x equal xi. And you just rerun the calculation. Okay? And this is simply the same thing with the absolute value. So it's, okay. So now that we have that, we can start to understand better what's going on. Because we can have a geometric understanding of a graph, of a relation with a graph. So in order to do so, we will rewrite it in another way. And in particular, we will focus on something. So it's a corollary. So this may seem boring, okay, all this formula, but we will give an interpretation to that afterwards. Okay, so this is a corollary is that 1 minus lambda 2 is equal to the mean over x perpendicular to 1, x different from 0, of the sum over uv of muv xu minus xv squared over xx. So, why is this nice? It's because basically this relates. So let me just write the following, the second term. It's also the mean over x perpendicular to 1 of the sum over uv of muv xu minus xv squared over the sum over uv of the same thing but without the muv. So here, what we have is the sum over muv of xu minus xv squared, and here we have the sum over all uv of xu minus xv squared. Okay? And we will give a sense to that. I will give you a sense to that. So first we will prove that, and then I will explain you why it's related to the expansion. How it's related to the expansion. Okay? So let's prove that. So basically, remember what we've said before. We've said that if all the eigenvalues are away from 1, and the further away they are, the faster we converge to the uniform distribution. And what does this say here? It's here, it's the distance between the second eigenvalue and 1. Okay, so this is somehow how bad this is. Okay, the larger this is, the better it is. And what's going on is that we will relate that with something here, this expression which may look ugly, okay? And we will show that this has a geometric meaning for the graph. Okay? And we will be able to understand. So basically what we will relate is how fast the random walk converge to some geometric property of the graph. Okay? So, alors, this is just calculation. Okay? This is just calculation, so you just compute the ratio and check that this is true. Okay, so let's do that. So proof. So what we know is that 1 minus lambda 2 is the mean for x perpendicular to 1, x different from 0, of 1 minus x m x t over x x t. Okay, it's just rewriting what we've done. So this, I can just rewrite it as x xt minus x m xt over x xt. Okay? So basically, I want to compare that with there is a 2 which is missing. There is a 2 here. So we just need to compare this numerator with that. So let's just do the calculation. It's just trivial. So m uv xu minus xv square. So this is xu square minus plus xv square minus 2 xu xv. Okay. Xu xv. So this is the sum over u v, the sum over u, sum over v of 2 luv xu square. Okay, use the fact that muv is symmetric. Okay, summing over u and then summing over v, it's the same as summing twice over u and v. Okay, so what we know is that this is 2. Okay, because muv is doubly stochastic. Minus 2 sum over uv of xu muv xv. This is xm xt. So what do we have here now? We have 2 what? 2 sum of xu square, which is xxt. Okay, so we just conclude that this is just the sum over uv of muv xu minus xv square over 2 xxt. Okay. Oh, trust me. That's good enough, okay? It's just trivial, calculation, okay? So now let's prove the second one. So why this is equal to the numerator? This does not appear clearly, okay? But let's think a little bit about it. So what is the sum over uv of xu minus xv squared? Okay, but again, it's the sum over uv of xu square plus xv square minus 2 xu xv. Okay? So, like before, it's 2n sum over u of xu square. So this is the squares here. So, but there is no muv, so you have to you have n that appear. Okay, you have the sum over this 1, so it's n. Minus 2 times the sum over xu, sum over xv. Okay, but x is perpendicular to 1. So the sum of xu is 0. So what you have now is that it's equal to 2n times x transpose of x, and you replace and you get that. Okay. So let's now make a sense to this formula. Let's now try to make a sense to give a signification here. And basically, let's say that G is n alpha extender. If if G N D alpha, so N D alpha expander, if G is d-regular and lambda of G is less than lambda. Okay, remember that lambda of G is the max over I different from 1 of lambda I. Or equivalently, the max of lambda 2, lambda I. N d alpha. Okay. So in particular, if so, of course, alpha strictly less than one. For alpha strictly less than one. So imagine that we have such an expander. Okay? We don't know whether they exist now. But so we know that they exist, but we don't know how to construct them. Okay? So well, we don't know yet that they exist. Okay? But we presume that they exist. So indeed, in fact, random graphs verify this property. The giant component of random graphs. Okay, so now imagine that we have that. So we have lambda of G, which is less than alpha. What does this mean? This means that this 1 minus lambda of 2, 1 minus lambda 2, okay, is larger than 1 minus alpha. Okay? So let's now try to understand what does this mean geometrically. So, what we know is that what we've seen. So, if G is a n d alpha strictly less than one expander, then the random walk on G converges exponentially fast to uniform. Okay? That's what we need. So now we may ask the question is, now that we have this formula, we may ask the question whether, okay, what does lambda 2 strictly less than 1 implies on G structure, on the structure of G? And we have a very nice theorem, which is a funny exercise to do, that tells that G is connected if and only if lambda 2 is strictly less than 1. Okay, so you have really a connection between the spectrum and graph properties. So let's prove it really, really fast. Can we go even faster? So let's assume. So first, suppose. Let's do the contraposé. Suppose that lambda 2 equals 1. Okay? So what does this mean? This means that x2 times m equals x2. Okay? But x2 is perpendicular to 1. Okay? So in particular, the sum over u of x2 u equals 0. But since x2 is different from 0, this implies that x2 U takes at least two values. One positive, one negative. Okay, so that the sum is equal to zero. Okay, but x2 times m u equals x2 u. But 1 minus lambda 2 equals, remember, this thing for lambda 2. It's equal to the sum over uv of muv x2 u minus x2 v square over 2 x2 x2 t. But lambda 2 equals 0, so this is equal to 0. Okay? This is equal to 1, but we don't care, it's equal to 0. So what's going on is that this sum is equal to 0. But this sum, it's only positive terms. Okay? This implies that for all uv, muv different from 0, implies that x2u equals x2v. Here we have a sum of positive terms which is equal to 0. This implies that all the terms are 0. This implies that if muv is not 0, then x2u has to be equal to xuv. But what does this mean if muv different from 0? This means that there is an edge between u and v. So what does this mean? So this is where we will start to make sense to this formula and how it relates to the graph. This implies that if uv belongs to E, then x2 u equals x2v. So x2, thus, x2 is constant in each connected component of G. But we know that x2 takes two values. So there are at least two connected components.
Can you make the conclude that what do you mean that x2 is constant?
Because every time there is an edge, yeah, x2 is the same, has the same value at both ends of the edge. So in any connected component, you have a path, and x2 is equal to x2, 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 it's equal. Every time you take an edge, x2 has the same value in both ends. So it has to be constant in each connected component. But we know that x2 takes more than two values, at least two values. So we have two constant connected components. Okay? The opposite direction is comes along this line, clearly. What do? Basically, you assume, so if J is not connected, then you take S, a connected component, okay, and Y equals, and you define a vector YU equals to the size of S bar over N, if U belongs to S, and the size of S over N, if U belongs to S bar. Why? Because, minus. Why? Because this ensures, so I'm not doing the calculation, I'm just giving you the value. But Y is perpendicular to 1, okay, and you can check that you have this equality. And thus, lambda 2 equals 0. Thus, lambda 2 equals 0. Okay, you just do the calculation with this thing, and you can see that basically this is trivial, that it is zero. Because what we've seen here is that when you see the numerator here, okay, we know that y is constant on every connected component. So this is zero on every connected component. But outside the connected component, this is zero. Okay, so lambda 2 equals 1. It's really trivial. That's a very good exercise for you to do.
So you wrote lambda 2 is zero. Yes, you meant one. You meant 1.
Yeah. Plus 1 minus lambda 2 equals 1. Okay, but there is nothing to write here. Okay, that's simply. So let's write n for all uv, n uv, yu, yv square equals 0. So that's done. Okay, so we start to see that this has to do with somehow the connectivity of the graph. Okay, and we will see more later on. But let's first ask us a question: can we draw an expander graph? Am I able to draw an expander? What time is it?
It's
6:10. 6:10. Oh, sorry. Okay. So, what does this express of the structure? So we've seen that G is connected if and only if lambda 2 is minus is strictly less than 1. Another thing is funny, and you have another lemma that tells you, so this is an exercise. Exercise, if G is connected, then G is bipartite, is equivalent to lambda n equals minus 1. So you can think about it, and using this inequality and this kind of trick here, like the yu vector, you can show that. Okay, so basically, there is a really strong relationship between the spectrum and some global property of a graph. Okay. So by the way, I can rewrite this. Or that, okay, that's the same thing. Okay, I can rewrite it as the sum over all uv uv of xu minus xv square times 1 over v. Okay, I can rewrite the numerator since this is the number of edge between u and v over d. I can just rewrite this sum as the sum over all the edges, 1 over d times the sum over all the edges of xu minus xv square. Okay? So, what I'd like to ask now is, okay, I don't know whether I will get one expander now. Okay? I don't have a construction yet. Okay? We will see later on how to construct. But imagine that you have one, and we would like to ask the question whether, can I draw an expander? Can I draw the picture of an expander? And so let's see, metric property. So first of all, an easy exercise. Okay, I will just give you every expander at diameter theta of log n. So in both definitions.